Welcome to Brains Matter, the podcast on science, curiosities, and general knowledge. I'm your host, just an ordinary guy. Hello everyone, and welcome to another episode of Brains Matter. It's been a little while since the last episode of the show, and my apologies for that. Those of you who follow me on social networking will know the reasons for it, but Brains Matter is back. On today's show, we continue our series on science communication, and in this episode, I talk to a man who needs no introduction. He's been communicating science for over 30 years, has been an editor for Scientific American magazine for over 15 years, and is the host of Scientific American's Science Talk podcast. I was lucky enough to talk to Steve on this topic. I'm talking to Steve Mirsky, who's on the board of editors at Scientific American magazine. He's also the host of the Science Talk podcast, and you'll hear him on the 60 Second Science podcast as well. He's written for many publications and is also a published author. So welcome to the show, Steve.
Thanks. Great to be here.
Just to start off with, could you give people a little bit of a background about what you do at Scientific American and some of the other things you do in terms of science communication?
Sure. I do a monthly column for the magazine, and I still, on rare occasions, edit one of the longer feature pieces in the magazine that's usually written by a scientist. Most of what I do these days and for the past 4.5 years has been the audio, the podcasts, because I had a little bit of a radio background. And when we decided at Scientific American to get involved in digital broadcasting and podcasting, they came to me just because I had that little bit of a radio background and asked me if I could do it. And I said, well, I guess so. Oh, why don't we try it? And so I would say that probably 90% of what I do now is the podcasting, whereas before that, 100% of what I did was working for the print magazine. So it's been a really kind of interesting mid-career shift. I mean, my job now is completely different from what it used to be, other than the fact that it's still all covering science for a more or less lay audience. But it's really kind of great because I've been able to do this new and exciting work without having to change employers. So mostly what I do is the audio, and you know the relationship though is pretty obvious. We're still trying to bring science and good science, important science, to the general public. The kind of real similarity is that I've always been one of the people at the magazine who covers pretty much anything and who looks for something that's more or less lighter or sometimes even just outright funny that we can put in the magazine or now on the podcasts to attract an audience and to remind them that science is done by people and people are funny, therefore some science is going to be funny.
Have you seen science, as it's been viewed in the public, change over the years, or has it?
I think so. I think that when I was younger, science and scientists were considered to be, you know, uber serious. And I remember studies where you would ask little kids what their image of a scientist was, and they would draw the stereotypical Albert Einstein only in a white lab coat, which is kind of funny because I don't think there's a photograph in existence of Einstein in a white lab coat, although one of your listeners will probably now write in with evidence that I'm wrong. But, you know, Einstein, obviously, the correct image is a piece of chalk for Einstein. Mm-hmm. But and scientists were, I think, more perceived in the past as complete kind of humorless and authority figures, where that's where you went. You would keep them in the basement, and that's where you would go to find out a particular piece of information, and then you would leave the basement and hope that they just stayed down there and did whatever kind of arcane, weird stuff that they were up to. I think that's the old image of scientists. I think that's probably still the image among some parts of the population. But I think more and more we see scientists as regular people who are engaged in this scientific activity. And I think that maybe we can go to the TV portrayals of scientists to really analyze that change. If you go back to TV and movies, if you go back to the sci-fi movies of the 50s, see that that the egg-headed scientist is a stereotype.
So the eggheads or the evil geniuses intent on taking over the world.
Absolutely. The evil geniuses is also a staple. And you kind of get this hybrid in the form. One of my favorite portrayals of a scientist is the professor from Gilligan's Island. Mm-hmm. I don't know if that was a popular show in Australia.
It certainly was.
Okay. And it's obviously referenced in that great movie Galaxy Quest. So I guess Gilligan's Island is a worldwide phenomenon. But the professor there, while still kind of geeky, is also a little bit more rugged, and he's somebody that everybody relies on for, you know, to save their lives. And then there's been this really interesting phenomenon in the last decade that's, I think, in great part driven by the CSI franchise of TV shows, where the scientist is now the hero.
Yeah,
and really is a regular person with heroic qualities, and the big brain is not anything to be ashamed of anymore. And you know, they do the work that really everybody needs to be done, and they save the day at the end. So I think that's been a really important change in the way the public views science. This plethora of programs where the scientist saves the day.
Just as a total aside for those fans out there of Gilligan's Island, sing the Australian National Anthem to the tune of Gilligan's Island, it's a 100% perfect fit.
Oh, I must try that sometime. That's hilarious.
Yes, Gilligan's Island was very popular in Australia for one reason or the other, either television or for the humour aspect of it too.
Well, I guess, you know, in some way, Australia is Gilligan's Island. Oh, now I'm going to get in trouble, you know, but maybe there's some way that it resonates with Australians, you being out there on your own giant island.
Yeah, the island continent that we are.
And exactly.
You're talking about the way the view of science has changed in entertainment especially. There has been a bit of a change for more positive roles such as CSI and forensics in a lot of law-type criminal television shows and movies. And you also have movies such as the modern adaptation of The Day the Earth Stood Still, where you have scientists who are central characters and so on. But then we get to staple, you know, sitcoms, I guess, if you want to call them that, such as The Big Bang Theory, where scientists are the main characters, but they're still seen as slightly geeky and not quite having the social skills that you would expect.
Absolutely.
Represented to be. And so we're moving, but, you know, perhaps we're not quite there yet. But one of the things that I always find interesting, and in terms of the general public, and I know this is something that you're quite familiar with, given a lot of the reports that you've come up with on 60 Second Science. I know you do a lot of baseball stories, and being an Australian, I do a number of discussions on cricket. And that is the perception of the average person of what their understanding of sport is in a general sense. Even if you're not a fan, you're aware of who the teams are, who the players are, how well certain teams have done and so on, versus what has been done in the science sphere. So which countries are doing research on what, who has won the Nobel Prize. So for example, in 2003 or 2004, whenever it was, when the two Australians won the Nobel Prize for Helicobacter pylori,
and
they drank it themselves and to prove their point, they won the Nobel Prize for Physiology or Medicine, and that's a big deal. Australia hasn't had as many Nobel Prize winners as, say, the US, you know, purely due to sheer numbers, I guess. But that same time, the Australian cricket team won the cricket series against England, the Ashes, for those in Australia who are familiar with it. And the cricket team got a ticker tape parade in every single capital city, and the story about the Nobel Prize was like page four news.
Well, that's really interesting that it wasn't page one news, although I'm not surprised about the parades. There's an old saying here in the U.S., it's hard to rally around the math team, which refers to the popularity of college football, you know, football here being a very different sport from soccer. And
well, in Australia, it's different to soccer. So we have Australian rules football, whereas you have
Australian rules, right? I've seen that on TV here. That's wildly entertaining. That's a really interesting point. I don't know what you could possibly do about it. Here in New York City, we have at various institutions, I believe, something like a dozen Nobel laureates, and they can walk down the street and be left completely alone. Whereas any of the local sports stars probably can't leave their apartments without armed guards. But that you've really hit on a very interesting kind of paradox within people, and it must have something to do with deep evolutionary programming about who's a hero and who isn't. But yeah, I don't know. It'd be nice if there was the same kind of wild reaction to science heroes, but I don't think we're going to be seeing that soon.
Oh, well, we can hope.
We can, I do, but I'm not optimistic in the near term anyway.
Well, that example I gave of the previous Nobel laureates back in, 5 or 6 years ago compared to last year, where a dual Australian citizen, Elizabeth Blackburn, won the Nobel Prize. She actually went to the university that I teach at. And that was actually bigger news, and that did make front page news. But I suspect part of that might have been because she was a woman.
Yeah, I was going to guess the same thing. It's still big news when women win the Nobel Prize, and it's great when women win the Nobel Prize. And I think, unfortunately, it may be a sign of equality when women are also ignored when they win the Nobel Prize.
It just asks Marie Curie, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, can you imagine what a big deal that must have been 100 years ago when she won the Nobel Prize? Yeah, it's pretty amazing to think about. In fact, if anybody's interested, if you find a good Curie biography, she was in some ways a huge media star of the day. Her private life was hugely scrutinized, and she almost didn't win the second Nobel Prize because she was having an affair with a married man, and that became a subject of intense international scrutiny. So it would have been the front page of whatever version of a scandal sheet they would have had back then. But anyway, that's going off on a tangent, interesting though it may be.
Even though that is a tangent, do you think that's a way of getting people hooked in, people like the personalities, people like hearing stories that they can relate to? And that's more of a human story. It's almost like a soap opera, really, something you could put into a movie to say, here's the life of Marie Curie, and get into the story behind it without having to be bombarded by the science for those who are afraid of it. Do you think that's a way of getting people into it?
I always did, even if the details about the person's personal life are not salacious. I always thought it was a way to get people involved. And yet it turns out that our profiles of scientists, where we talk less about their science and more about their lives and them as people, are not nearly as popular as I would have expected them to be. I still think there's probably a market out there for people interested in scientists as people, especially if you can somehow relate their particular path in life to the science they do or how they got interested in the science they do. But it just hasn't turned out to be as popular as stories about the science itself rather than the people doing it.
We've talked about trying to get people into science. Do you think humor as a method is a good way to get people into science? And one thing that I know you're familiar with is the IgNobel Prizes. Do you think that's a good way of getting people to be interested? Because it makes, as the motto goes, it makes you laugh and then makes you think. But at the same time, there are some people who might argue that some of the experiments that they're talking about are a waste of time and a waste of public money and private money as well.
Yeah, you raise really good points there. And I've I've been to the Ig Nobel Prize ceremony. I can't remember if it was two times or three times, because I used to go way back in the early 90s when it was just starting up. And I have mixed feelings. It's an incredibly entertaining, fun evening, the whole ceremony itself. And it does indeed bring science to a lot of people who ordinarily might not pay attention to it. The danger is that it may perpetuate some stereotypes of scientists as nerdy, geeky, strange, outlier people mm-hmm. who do weird stuff that's not important. And I know that we get mail from some people who think that, for example, Sean Carroll — there are two Sean Carrolls, I'm talking about Sean M. Carroll, who's the molecular biologist, and not Sean B. Carroll, who's the very well-known physicist and cosmologist — but Sean M. Carroll studies how spots form on butterfly wings. And when we have covered him, we get mail from people who are irate that federal funds, you know, money raised and then given out by the government for research, goes to what they see as being this complete waste of time and resources, the spots on butterflies' wings. And the problem there, and that might be, for example, something that the Ig Nobels might have given tribute to, although I don't think they did. And Sean Carroll is an incredibly serious researcher, and we do not do a good enough job of explaining to people why that is important research, and that what you do, for example, in that case, is not just explicate how butterfly wings get their spots. What you're doing is looking at the mysteries of development in general, which may have huge implications for the prevention of birth defects in humans, or for doing away with diseases that are genetic in origin. None of that stuff seems to matter sometimes when this sillier material can be put on stage. So I worry about it a little bit, although I think that for the most part, it generates more goodwill than bad feelings. So, but I think it'd be great if some of the research that appears to be silly, if a little bit of time were devoted to explain why it had some kind of positive effect, or wound up informing other research that was obvious more importance.
Mm-hmm. And I don't remember the name of the person, but there was someone who won the Ig Nobel Prize and then went on to win the Nobel Prize as well.
Yeah, it was just this year. It was Andre Geim, who just won the physics prize.
That's right.
And who a decade ago, I think, won the Ig Nobel for levitating a frog, I think it was.
And he was the one who won it for graphene, wasn't he?
Yes, exactly. And he had used a superconducting magnet to levitate a frog or something like that. I don't remember. So actually, that's kind of a breakthrough event that this person has won both. So maybe he can serve as the Rosetta Stone and bridge both sides of this issue.
Now let's take a little bit of a break for our listener of the episode. And today's listener of the episode is Joshua Wieskopf. Thanks for your support, Joshua.
Do you want to own a piece of Brains Matter? Just go to the Brains Matter website and click on merchandise. Then you have the opportunity to buy shirts, mugs, or a vast range of other items. Support the show and show the world that friends really do matter.
You mentioned before in your answer the fact that the way we report it, we as in those in the science communication community or arena, how do you see, and given your background, how do you see the differences, or is there much of a difference between the way science is reported in print versus new media, so podcasting is your passion, for example, right now. How do you think that's changed over the years, or has it changed the world of science communication?
Well, I think science communication is definitely different. I've been doing this for about 25 years, and I think it's very different from when I started. For one thing, there's so much more of an appetite for it, if not directly from the general public, in the form of websites devoted to it. And so there's an endless supply of science information that goes out to the general public, and therefore there's this kind of gaping maw that needs to be filled with science news. And so you'll see pretty much any story that's published in a decent enough journal that could be of interest to the general public will get some kind of coverage, even if it's just a rewritten press release someplace, or not even rewritten. It might just be reprinted. But I know that for the podcasts, it's going to be a different kind of selection pressure for a story. I mean, something I say to freelance contributors is that a story that would be an obvious fit for the print magazine may just be too difficult to get across in audio form or in video form. Mm-hmm. Whereas another story that might not necessarily be of interest to the editorial staff at the magazine or the magazine's readers is going to be an obvious one for the podcast because it's a story related to sound. Mm-hmm. So if somebody has done some new research into bird song, for example, you know, I'm going to jump all over that as the editor of the podcasts because it's making the best use of the medium. Whereas if there's a story that really needs to be unpacked, as they say, which really needs to be slowly and carefully described and explained, well, that's the obvious place for a longer format print story. So in a lot of ways, the medium itself is going to dictate which story is good for it. And, you know, the most obvious example, and it has nothing directly to do with science coverage, is for any TV coverage, if you don't have the video, you really can't run the story unless you're going to be content with an interview format where you just have two people talking to each other.
Yeah.
But, you know, it could be the greatest story in the world, and if you don't have the pictures, they're not going to run it most of the time. Whereas it could be a mediocre story, but if they have pictures to run with it, then you put it on TV, and then you have the perfect storm of stories we just saw. I'm sure in Australia, the rescue of the Chilean miners was a really big deal. Mm-hmm. And that's the ultimate television story, because you have this dramatic story and then you have these incredible pictures. And the only thing that could have made the American coverage better would have been if the broadcasters themselves would have shut up. I don't know what your coverage looked like. But I'm sitting here watching the TV set and saying, will you people just shut up so I can see what's going on? They kept breaking in to tell me how emotional this was, thereby destroying whatever emotional impact the pictures themselves had. So, you know, different stories are good in different media, and people should get out of the way of stories sometimes. One of the things with a funny science story that I always tell people is there's three kinds of funny stories. A story can be made funny, a story can be born funny, or a story can have funniness thrust upon it. So, you know, some stories are just inherently funny. Years ago, I covered this guy who wanted to figure out whether or not the bald heads of turkeys were a thermoregulatory function or a sexual selection function. And so the only way for him to do that was to figure out whether the bald heads were related to heat dissipation. And the only way to do that was to make the turkeys not bald anymore. So he's putting sweat socks on turkeys' heads and then putting them in hot environments and seeing how well they radiate the heat. And, you know, a story like that, the best thing to do, just tell the story. Don't try to make it funny, because it's pretty funny. And then there are other stories where you can, with the language, make it a funny story. So the turkey guy, that story's born funny. Mm-hmm. Some other stories you can make funny. They could go either way. And then you can take anything and, you know, with the proper language, you can make it a humor story. And those are the stories that have funniness thrust upon them. The medium dictates the story sometimes, and the story can be handled in any number of ways, really, a lot of the time.
And one thing that we've noticed over the years as well is, I don't know about the US, but especially here in Australia, and I know it's a big problem in the UK, is less people are studying science, more people are going towards businesses and those type of commerce degrees and those sorts of things. One of the reasons people are considering is the lack of quality teachers in the classroom to encourage people into science, and this comes back to how well science is communicated in general to the public, and especially to children when they're young. And you mentioned before, when we were talking about the Ig Nobel Prizes, about the way science is communicated. What do you think can be done to help improve the excitement that children might have about science? Do we expose them to more of it on television and general media? Do we report in slightly different ways? Do you think there's something we can do to help, you know, solve that root issue?
Yeah, I think we should leave them alone. I think they're a lot of children are natural scientists, and we get in the way by putting them into rigid environments and then saying, okay, now we're going to do the science, and we make it boring. Whereas little kids are natural scientists, you know, digging around in the dirt and collecting insects and asking all kinds of questions about why the sky is blue. And they, you know, they love going to museums and seeing the dinosaur skeletons. Little kids love science. We beat it out of them. Mm. We should leave them alone more. So we should stop segregating science into this weird ghetto and just remind everybody, especially little kids, how it's everywhere you look. Everything is science, really, when you break it down, and especially if a little kid shows any sign of interest, cultivate it. But also, we can point out what science is when little kids or adults even see it and don't realize they're seeing it. One of the things I do every once in a while is take the New York Times front page, which may have anywhere from 8 to 12 different stories on it, and go through those stories and show people how many of those stories could legitimately have been assigned to the science desk. You might have the Chilean miner story. The science desk could have done most of it. It's all science and engineering. Anything to do with nuclear power controversies, a lot of times the political reporters might get that story, but it could have been a science story. You know, anything you can think of, really. Airline regulations, airline safety, any transportation stories, oil stories. These are all science stories. Unfortunately, we're cutting back on the science coverage in at a lot of the newspapers in the U.S. I mean, a lot of the newspapers are in trouble. So we actually have fewer qualified people doing those stories, fewer people with a good science background doing those stories, and more people who don't understand the science and therefore are liable to be led in the wrong direction, possibly by sources who have a vested interest in one side or the other.
Yeah, and I think climate change is a perfect example of that, where the argument, in quotation marks there, is presented by the general media as a 50-50 split, whereas in reality it's not.
Yeah, it's the biggest example. You're absolutely right. And there's also a false objectivity that journalists adopt that pretty much makes every story a 50-50 split. You know, what is the Earth round? Well, we have two experts, one from the side that believes the Earth is round and one from the Flat Earth Society. Gentlemen, how are you today? Yeah. You know, it's ridiculous.
That impacts people's perceptions as well, because you see some of the comments that come back into the newspapers and television shows, and they say, oh, look, there's no agreement on this, so how can we believe it? Whereas if you look at the... I remember reading a study done about 4 or 5 years ago about all the papers written since, I think it was about 1971, by climate scientists, and not a single one of them denied man-made climate change.
It's such an open and shut case within the science community, but, you know, here in the States, you have an entire political party that doesn't believe that there's a problem. There's no Republican Senate candidates who accept that there's a problem with the climate. In fact, most of them think that it's a big hoax because, and this is truly hilarious, the scientists have made up this hoax to try to generate funds from the government for their research. So they're in it for the money.
The exact same argument that the conservatives in Australia and I think the UK as well use. The Australian conservatives aren't quite as radical as the American ones, I guess, but their party platform is one where they do not believe, either they do not believe or they do not accept that it is man-made, or that the impact of it is what the scientists claim it will be. So therefore, they're pretty much all systems go, drive your V8, four-wheel drives, we're not going to worry about it because it's going to affect the economy, as opposed to, well, what's really going to happen if this, and when this does happen, what's going to happen to the economy then?
That's the really great point. Yes, if you're really worried about the economy, do something about this now, because the economy 30 years from now is going to be in real trouble because of this problem.
It wasn't Nicholas Stern, but someone from the UK or Europe who was writing that we need to, if we don't do anything within the next 5 years, we'll need to spend $1 trillion a year per country to be able to rectify the situation.
Yeah, I'm certainly no expert in that kind of cost-benefit analysis and what kind of money is going to need to be spent. But it's clearly a serious problem that people don't take seriously. And, you know, if you extend that line of reasoning, I'd have to say the people who don't take it seriously are not serious people. There's nothing here in the U.S., there's absolutely nothing that I can see that can be done to convince people whose entire political careers have been made on being unconvincible, other than the Tom Friedman approach, which is you try to get people to go for changes that will bring energy security and with them lower carbon emissions, and with energy security, lower carbon emissions. And the lower carbon emissions are just going to be going along for the ride because, you know, these people won't believe that that's a good thing. The only thing you can convince them might be a good thing is if we weren't importing so much foreign oil. Yeah. And so that's the only hope you have. And then you get the real positive payoff by doing something about climate change, you know, sort of secretly. Yeah. So they don't know that they were part of that.
Do science without calling it science.
Yeah. Let the science inform the policy, but sneak it past people by having national security be the real motivation for the policy, right?
And so what do you think can be done, apart from what's already being done in the public sphere at the moment, to help promote science to the general public?
I think you remind people about how much science is all around them and that things that they take for granted are in fact science. When they watch some silly program that they get a kick out of, remind them that the only reason they can watch that program is because the scientists and engineers figured out how to make television, mm-hmm. and send those signals their way through satellites or fiber optic cables. You know, there's so much science and technology that permeates our lives. People walk around all the time now with their smartphones out, and everybody's connected to the web in this incredibly personal way, and yet they might not think of themselves as being interested in science when they've allowed themselves to become cybernetic organisms. And still they think that they have no interest in it. I think there must be ways to to constantly remind people that their entire existences, and this is brought home anytime we have a breakdown in the power grid, and we've had a couple of major blackouts on the east coast of the U.S. in the last few decades, and all of a sudden people are really aware of how much they like science. When we don't have electricity, it becomes a really important thing in people's lives. They may never have heard of James Clerk Maxwell, but they sure do like that electricity.
Certainly do.
So I think we could do a better job of just telling them how much their lives are intertwined with scientific advancement and scientific research in general. And we really need to somehow convince politicians that an investment in scientific research and engineering is the best investment they can make. It pays for itself, you know, so many fold and so quickly. And yet it's the money that's spent by governments on some parts of scientific research is unbelievably piddling. It's round off errors in a lot of other things like defense or Wall Street bailouts here in the States. I mean, literally round off errors. We might be talking about a couple of million dollars in some cases, or a couple of tens of millions of dollars that could be devoted to starting up an entire field of research into alternative energy or better battery storage for electric vehicles, things like that. I mean, really small amounts of money in the big picture. And yet the political will is almost non-existent to do those things. And part of it has to be laid, part of the blame has to be laid at the feet, not of the politicians, but of the voters who themselves are either ignorant or dispassionate about those kinds of activities and don't make it a point to remind their legislators that they want these things to be invested in, and they want these things to happen, and that the future, you know, we can go either way in the future. And right now it doesn't really look good because people are kind of ignorant about what their priorities need to be, and the political will doesn't exist. And, you know, if we don't remind people how important investing in R&D is, it's really not going to be a happy future, I think.
On a final note, who are your favorite science communicators?
My favorite science communicators? Well, I'm a big fan of the writer David Quammen, who used to do a column for Outside Magazine and has written a couple of really terrific books, including collections of his columns have been published. And he also wrote a really great book called Song of the Dodo about biogeography, island biogeography, and another one called The Monster of God about the last few predators who are still living on the Earth, the predators of humans, that is. Other science communicators, we have some of the other writers at Scientific American I'm a big fan of, obviously. The great David Attenborough.
Yeah, I was going to mention him as well. So one of the pioneers of zoology and botany right from the 50s, and I think he paved the way for other fantastic people like Julius Sumner Miller in Australia and Carl Sagan in the US. And going back to the point you made before, he did it without making people think they were watching science.
Exactly. Attenborough. David Attenborough did such a fabulous job of showing us what science is in a way that made it fun and exciting. That was not my best David Attenborough, but it'll have to do for now. Yeah, David Attenborough.
An icon now, so right. Everyone knows the voice if they don't know the name. It's
exactly.
Well, Steve Mirsky, I'd like to thank you very much for your time today on Brains Matter.
Oh, it's my pleasure. Oh, and don't forget your own Robin Williams. He's a great radio man.
We will never forget Robin Williams.
Right. Great to talk to you. Thanks very much.
And that's it for part one of this interview. Join me next time for part two of the interview with Steve. In the meantime, I'd like to thank everyone who supported the show in any way over the past 4 or so years. The show would be nothing without you all. And if you know of an organisation that's willing to sponsor science communication, and would like to support Brains Matter, please contact me. In the meantime, I'll leave you with a quote from Richard Feynman. There are 10 to the power of 11 stars in the galaxy. That used to be a huge number, but it's only 100 billion. It's less than the national deficit. We used to call them astronomical numbers. Now we should call them economical numbers. Bye for now. Thanks for listening to the show. You can check out the Brains Matter website at www.brainsmatter.com. That's www.brainsmatter.com. And you can find all the other episodes of the show there. Just click on the podcast link on the right hand side. You can listen to the episodes from your browser by choosing Flash Player from the links and selecting whichever episode you want to hear from within the player. There's also other information on the site, such as links to articles and news, subscription details, both via iTunes and manually, and voting information. Please vote for the podcast on Podcast Alley, and remember to vote every month, since the votes reset at the start of each month. If you want to support the show, have a look at the Support the Show link. You can make a donation via PayPal, or you can buy a book through one of the Amazon links on the support page. If you have any comments or suggestions, you can leave an entry on this episode's show notes on the webpage, or you can send me an email. All my contact information can be found on the site. The theme music Future is performed by Cut Copy and comes courtesy of Glenn Gertz from Modular Records. I hope you enjoyed the show. Bye for now.
Ghetto in the classroom. Sorry about that. Let me answer it just so I can get off the line quicker. Hello.
Hi, Steve.
Hi. I'm right in the middle of a radio interview. Can I call you back?
Yes.
Okay. Thanks.
Okay.